Welcome back, all of you across Europe. Welcome back to the Canoe Marathon European Championships on Lake Bohinj in Slovenia this wonderful afternoon. We will have the final discipline, K2 men. K2 men with 20 bouts on the start line, about 20 bouts on the start line, and some of them are really, really good ones, very experienced. Bout number 709, for instance, is José Ramalho and Ricardo Carvalho from Portugal. José Ramalho, who won a great race yesterday, he will start also today. But we also have Spain, Ivan. And Spain has some incredibly good crews here.
Not just good crews, but they've got two crews that are good. So they very often you see them out the front on their own, helping each other out for at least the first half of the race. Towards the end of the race, sometimes you see them actually hinder each other. So you've got the probably the favourite, Buzan and Fuser. I think they're the stronger of the two Spanish crews. Then you got the two guys who we saw race yesterday, Merchan and Alonso, both out there for a couple of hours in the heat yesterday. And you saw the state Ramalho was in when he came in. He was lying in the air-conditioned ICF hut. Nobody's allowed in there, right?
Exactly.
Not even we're allowed in there, but no. He can get in. And he can lie on the floor, and he was not well at all. He's actually racing with Cavallo, who's his best friend. And I'm not sure how serious they are about the race. I know they'll be trying hard because that's how athletes work, but I'm not sure how much of a contender they'll be.
Emilio Merchan and Ivan Alonso won last year. They are both number 717, and off they are. And it's
closest to us, boat 701. Got a full length lead already.
And that is France with Stéphane Boulanger and Jeremy Candy. We haven't seen them together before, but Stéphane Boulanger have done quite a lot in previous times. And also on the inside of them is Italy. Italy that always is among the top guys, at least at the first stages of the race.
I think Boulanger in the front of that French boat, he came second in the under 23 K1 quite a while back, yes, in Banyoles now. And he had been fourth before that, way back in 2007. Mm. So he's been around a long time, but we haven't seen him for a long time either.
He used to be there, but and they are all forming up in a big group, and I think we will see. I don't think anyone really want to do very hard work during this very hot conditions, so they will stay quite well together. Another interesting boat is actually Adam Jakub and Tomasz Jacek. Tomasz Jacek, who have been around a very long time, he's 42 years old, he's a team manager for the Czechish team, the team coach, but he's still very strong. He finished his top efforts on the racing courses and on the marathon courses 2 years ago, but he's doing a slight comeback here today together with Adam Jakub, and they have done a lot of racing here together over the years.
Interesting that he's actually older than the entire Swedish crew.
Exactly. That's right.
Swedish guys are the youngest in here. I mean, one of them's still a junior.
Yes. Right?
And so it's an experience event for them, I guess. They'll be on a steep learning curve here, yeah, against some of these.
They're actually first year senior and second year senior, these Emil Torstensson and Nils Thoresson, youngsters.
Great Britain, one to watch as well here. Daniels and Pendle, they were third in this event last year and fourth. Well, Pendle was part of a crew that came fourth the year before. He's been fifth in the past as well. They were sixth last year in Oklahoma. So they're front group potential. And even if things go well for them, anyone who's front group potential is also medal potential.
Absolutely so. And then we have the Hungarians, where we had Hungary that always does well. And this is I think the top crews of them is Adrian Boros and Laszlo Szolty, who are doing their second marathon race here this afternoon. They finished fourth in the Europeans last year, but also fourth in the World Championships in Oklahoma.
And didn't Szolty win this weekend already?
Exactly.
In the under-23s?
Exactly. He won the under-23. So they will absolutely be among the top guys. Hungary, that is racing in green shirts, boat number 715. The second Hungarian boat is Gere Balint Gere and Martin Metsaros. And they haven't been racing together, as far as I know, on the international courses before. So it will be interesting to follow them as well.
Mazaros is a good Hungarian kayaking name. The lady in the front of there, probably one of their best K4s ever, was Mazaros.
Yes. So and also Balint is quite a common name.
Okay. So maybe they've got family history of kayaking. You see the Spanish going around on the left-hand side there. They're obviously deciding to change their position. And they are going for it. In fact, everyone's come to them, which is one plan that really works well. If things aren't going well for you, do something spectacular and the whole race will form around you. Then you start picking your places after that. But two separate groups there. Left-hand group looks to me like it's the leading group of the two. But if the other one was far behind, it would have tucked in behind them, not be out to the side still. So they still fancy their chances of coming across and getting on equal terms.
And these guys are doing 8 laps, which is 30 kilometers, 8 full laps. Each lap, except the first one, has a portage where they jump out their boat, running across a plus 100 meter track, and then jump in once again and continue. The first lap is without portage, and that is just because it could be very, very crowded into that first portage, and things could crash and the boats breaks and such things, and we want to avoid that.
Bit of a strange thing in shot there. It looks like a blue team, presumably the Italians, must have had a swim, early swim maybe, got back in their boat, and they are clearly very, very far behind. That's a very tough call then. I mean, you're not going to catch anyone, are you, from there, really?
Maybe. It depends a bit.
You're certainly not going to get the result at once. So it looks like the French still.
Yes.
To their right, the Great British team.
And to the left,
and
Spain.
And to the left, the Spanish. Nice one by Tim Pendle there from Norwich Canoe Club. Andy Daniels from Longreach, who we've seen so many of their athletes. Magnus Gregory won earlier this week in the junior. They've got a great training group. They all train together, seniors, juniors, the lot. They do all their sprint, marathon training. But there's the French looking particularly tidy. Now, the French have won this race before, not with this crew, but in the past. I know they won when the race was in France a few years back. I actually lost just to remember what the name of the crew was that did that. So I'm a little bit embarrassed about that, but we'll brush over that and pretend you never heard it. So through the heat haze at the end, there is a little bit of a breeze this afternoon, which they'll be grateful for, and there is rumour that breeze may bring in a bit of cloud cover and even a bit of rain later. But for now, there's the graphic: Boulanger, Pendle, Bouzin, Gier, Merchan, Szolty, Graziani, Peters and Corin from Belgium, Faria again out there today, and then Romalo. Today we'll try and get Ferrier actually in the right boat. Yesterday I think I muddled him up with the French athlete throughout the entire race, for which obviously I apologise. And then back down through the order there, Polish, Czechs. But it's still a big group, everything to play for. Early days, and learn another test for someone. It's hard to see which boat tried to come around, but Pendle and Daniels very comfortable holding them off. They've found themselves in the lead. Not the worst place to be in a situation like this, but not for long. Oh no, the Spanish just came up as if they were going to hold someone off. Now they've let someone round. I can only suspect that's the other Spanish they've let round, otherwise there'd be no real reason for doing it. So it could be. I do notice Pendle and Daniels winning. I do notice the Spaniards in the diamond wash behind them. And I think it's probably the Spaniards on their left also. So you got the impression after yesterday's race, Stefan, that Alonso and Merchan were beginning to feel their age a little bit. They mentioned aged a couple of times in the interview I gave them.
Yes.
And when you start thinking that way, do you think it's a downhill slide from there when
Absolutely.
You start using age?
The day you don't develop anymore, the day the thinking is not on development, just to try to keep your form, keep your shape, then it's over.
Yeah. And they're extremely gracious about the efforts of Pedersen yesterday.
Yes.
Yeah, they were very, they're full of praise for him in the interview, even straight after a race where they gave him a bit of a hard time. It was good to see that.
Really good. The friendship of canoeing. Mats Pedersen, the Dane, 19-year-old Dane, that finished four yesterday in this wonderful K1 race. Here's the results from the first turn. And they are all there within a couple of seconds.
Pretty much it doesn't really matter where you are in that group, you're still part of it. It's a bit like the cycling peloton in that respect. They all give them the same time. We've got another crew coming back. Not only the crew in blue that we saw earlier, this could easily be a Polish crew, red and white boat, white shirts. Things haven't gone well for them, but at the moment it's Pendle and Daniels paddling through the heat haze. We know the Spaniards are there, French are there somewhere. Just trying to have a quick count up of boats there. We're looking at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, maybe 7 boats, which means there has been a bit of a split. The second group on a visual that we can get from our tent, not do you have that view. It looks like about 10, 15 seconds down to another group of about 4. So good work from the Great Britain team there. They've obviously caused that split with the speed they're going. And there may even be gaps opening up towards the back of this group now. So there you can see the gap between that leading group, the chasing pack. The chasing pack are chasing. You can see it's not easy for them back there.
We got some messages in here that the live stream is working very slowly or not at all on different places around Europe. The problem we face here is too little bandwidth for this kind of broadcasting. We are trying to cope with that, but it's not the fault of the organizations, neither to us. It's just that we are in a remote place in Slovenia where it's not enough bandwidth. Actually, but everything will be on YouTube, so it's possible to watch afternoon. I know it's very frustrating when you have your athletes there and really want to watch the race, but we are doing the best we can to solve the problem.
Okay, so Pendle and Daniels leading out, Alonso Merchan on their left. Can't distinguish which Hungarian crew it is on their right, but they're definitely Hungarian. The other Spanish crew, Fiuza, Alvarez, they're in the tail, in the V-wash diamond behind, and it looks like the second group have made contact again. And could have been a Portuguese effort there that closed that gap. But everyone's very happy to let Pendle and Daniels lead. And they're about a minute away now from the first turn, which on every subsequent lap will mean coming in for the portage. But not this first time. It's straight round and back up to the top turn. So there's only one boat made that jump across from the back. There's still three back there, 10 seconds behind.
Maybe we could have the full graphics on the screen now, once again, when everyone has passed the first turn. Many people are asking.
Graphics will be the second turn, Stefan.
Okay.
So here they come. It's a little bit crowded in there. So Pendle, Merchan, Buzan Fernandez, Gir Mezeros, that's the Hungarian boat to the right of Pendle and Daniels. Graziani, Bonassini, they're on the far left. Boulanger, I can't position him in the group because the graphics cover the group for me, but that's okay. We got the Belgians in there, Peters and Corrin. The other Portuguese boat, Faria, Maciel, and then Romalo and Cavallo. So it's a big group. In a big group of K2s like this, you rely, as the front man, as the driver, you rely very heavily on your back man for information. You don't need him to be making decisions to whether you go faster or not. You just need a gradual, steady, sensible stream of information. If I'm the driver, I need to know if anything's happening before I can see it. And that's something you teach your back man to do for you. And it's something they need to know. So here, looks like the Spanish are pushing up just a little. That's Alonso Merchan. See the Italians to their left, easily distinguishable by the flag at the front of their boat. It's looking very busy in there. I think that was, there's an incident of some sort. Pendles and Daniels didn't come out of that well. I think they're the second back from that group now. So from the back of that front group, the second crew back is Pendle and Daniels. Somebody tipped the back of their boat. You just saw them veer off to the right slightly. It all got a bit crowded when the lead changed, but they've made their way up the outside of the group. Belgians on this side, that's Corrin. He already raced yesterday. Italians there. Portuguese with a white hat on. And Alonso. In fact, the second Spanish crew just going past Alonso. And Merchan there. That's Buzan and Fernandez. And it's all slowed down again to a more manageable pace. It's so easy in these situations just to have a little bit of contact. No one wants it, but it happens. And a little bit of contact just disturbs the direction of your boat. And all of a sudden, things aren't looking quite so rosy for you. Meanwhile, round the bottom turn comes the whichever blue team it was.
It is.
It could be Adam and
Thomas. Adam Jakob and Thomas
Jezek.
So age is taking a toll on Thomas now. He was once one of the very top athletes in marathon racing for a decade or more. And now he's the team manager for the Czechish team, but jumped in here to do the K2 together with...
He got as high as second place,
Adam Jakob,
in one of the world championships.
Exactly. They were always up there. And he raced both K1 and K2. K2 together with Odvarko, mostly. And then switched to K1 when Jakob came and took the K2 with Odvarko.
So you get some idea of the size of the scenery from that shot. Tiny, tiny boats, huge mountains going up, stretching up, still not at the top, and there you go. That's the size of the basin we're in. When we went up in the cable car to the ski center, which is pretty much on the left of your picture, you can't quite see it, then you could see how the whole bowl was formed. Absolutely stunning scenery. We're getting a bit of a treat there from the cameraman. A couple of tourist paddlers out there. Not the worst place to be if you're in an open Canadian out for the day, eh?
It's absolutely marvellous here.
It is roasting hot here today. Sitting in the commentary tent, shorts and a t-shirt. Bizarrely, Stefan's chosen to wear the cow mascot outfit today for today's commentary. I'll leave you to picture that. I'm struggling to hold it together here. So still a little bit of action in that group there. But settling in, I think, as ever with all these races this weekend, any damage that's going to be done to someone is going to be done on this first portage. Still a long way from that yet. But already around now, some of those crews that are flailing around in the back looking for spaces need to be start thinking about what's going to happen in about 6-7 minutes time, actually a bit more than that, 8 minutes time, when they get back to the portage. very tempting to just relax and sit on the wash you're on and just wait for that to take you along. But even if you're in the best place in the group, you have to have an eye on what might happen, what could happen, and of course, what is actually happening. So it looks like a couple of boats at the back on the right there, Stephen. They look like they're just a little bit detached.
They are. It's quite rough behind such a big K2 group, and when it's rough, there is always washes to hang on to. But it's also quite demanding to both to find them and to be there, especially if you haven't this great experience of the many years into the racing.
Now you've raced both. You've raced K2, K1.
Absolutely.
I've started off as a
K2 paddler, but I can't say I've had any results in that. Switched to K1 and then continued that for the entire canoeing life.
I sort of switched backwards and forwards a couple of times there and did a bit of both. There are differences, obviously. But one of the biggest differences, actually, is if you do really well in your K1, it's almost a lonely feeling sometimes. It's just you. You can't really express it to someone else. At least with a K2, there's someone else that understands exactly how it felt, how hard it was. And that's quite comforting. Equally, on the flip side of that, it's during training you've got two people to worry about, and if your partner's not pulling his weight, or even if you perceive that he's not pulling his weight, then that can become very stressful. But at the moment, here we are back with the front group, two Spaniards, Great Britain, very tidy there from the Great British boys. Tucked in the back is Hungary, out on the left is Italy, France tucked in behind them,
Portugal is there,
and Portugal, and who's in the red cap there, Stefan? Any?
I think it's... it might be Portugal.
I'll try and get back to you with confirmation of that.
They will soon pass the timing point. It's so hot up there. It is.
So that could be the Danish.
Faria Maciel.
Or the Danish. Black and Rion, they could be in the red.
Yeah. Faria and Maciel, the Portuguese, are within the top group anyway. Faria, that did a good race yesterday, that was slow, and he was slowing down the big pack when Ramalho made his move out on the next last lap, where he really decided on the gold medal.
That's the second group. They're trying to work their way around, working out. Hopefully, they.
It's Sweden that make a move there on the outside, trying to catch the wash of, I think it's Italy or Czech Republic in the blue. It's Czech Republic.
Nice sized group for covering the distance,
it's
though.
Perfect. A great, good move there from the young Swedish guys, Emil and Nils. Emil Torstensson and Nils Thoresson. Nils Thoresson's father used to race K2 in marathon racing as well. Participated in the World Championships in Nottingham 88 together with Michaela Lindblad's father, actually.
Oh, wow.
Who is here as well this weekend.
Yeah, rounding the top turn. Going across the top of the lake there. Spain 1-2, Great Britain 3, Hungary 4, but those numbers are fairly meaningless. They're all in the same group. What we saw yesterday, the stronger paddlers tended, while the group was big, to be up the front end of the group. It's a slightly safer place to be, a couple more options. Now, Pendle and Daniels also medalled. Last year they were third. So you've actually got the first, the second, and the third crews in the first three places as this race stands. Salty Boros tucked in the diamond there.
Once again, the results there, of course, the same. And it's 10 bouts, about 10 bouts within 5 seconds. Very close.
Now they're definitely, their thoughts will be turning now towards the next turn and then the portage.
It's very good if the producer can put on the graphics when all of them have passed as well. It's many people out there asking for their athletes that is further down the line.
So a little bit of change of order at the back there. You can see the crew with the red hat there working really quite hard compared to the guys, Great Britain guys in the white boat with the yellow tips just to their left. See the stroke rate is much higher, but they're not making enough progress around. Tim Pendle at this stage will have his eye on them, and if they get even close to level with him, he'll just put a little spurt on and get them back to where he thinks they belong. So very relaxed for those front three, four boats. The others fighting it just a little. I think heat is going to be one of the factors in this race later on.
Absolutely so.
So it's going to be important for these guys to take on drinks when they can. And if they wait until they're thirsty, it's going to be too late. So another time check there. Confirmation that the front group is still 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. About 10 boats. They pulled almost a minute out on the chasing pack. There are two boats between the lead pack and the following four that we got a shot of earlier, including the Swedish paddlers. There's two lone boats stuck between those groups. But now they can see just a minute away from them that turn, the first turn before the first portage. I think the Spanish will be happy to stay at the front for that. I think they will have Pendle, Daniels, I think they'll be pretty confident that the Spanish will lead in. All they have to
Absolutely.
Do is maintain their position
Absolutely.
On that wash. That simplifies their job a bit.
I think we will see the same development that as yesterday. These very experienced Spanish crews will try to hold initiative and play very, very cool over the portage, as will the British. It will be tougher further down in this big group into the first portage. Big group into the first portage in K2 means struggles, risk of struggles and crashes and accidents.
It's just sheer number of bodies
it
in
is.
A small space. There's if there's 10 boats, there's 20 people on a landed stage that actually, even if you had 20 people without boats and 20 pairs of paddles, would be a crowd.
Absolutely.
So here we go. Just entering into the turn. Count the boys round. It's going to be five boys. There's the first. Spain's still very relaxed at the front. They'll be waiting. They'll have an eye out. The back paddlers will have an eye out for somebody attempting to come round and change the order. But so far, nobody's made that move. Certainly the boat Pendle's Daniels won't be motivated to make it. They'll be happy to sit with the Spanish. Speed slightly increasing. The reason you slightly increase the speed is just to discourage attack. If you go too slow, everyone fancies their chances. If you go a little bit faster, they think, okay, it's fast enough, we won't attack just now. But that group, you can see head-on shot of that group. You can see how busy it is. You see how they maintain spaces between them. Hungarians struggling in the back with a white cap on there. They're floundering just a little bit.
The British team does very, very, very well on the right-hand side there. They will catch the right side of the pontoon, I think, as the Spanish take the left side.
Really no attacks. It's those front four boats look very, very comfortable, plus the Italians, so five boats. Everyone else looks like they're pretty much happy to be there, but they're not going to contribute. So it looks like five strong boats and five hangers on. There's a lot of confusion at the portage. Hungarians still not out of their boat. They're floundering coming in. They're still there now. They're still there. Going to empty out their boat. And it's going to be tough for them. Meanwhile, on the run, Pendle's Daniels through, Spanish through, two Spanish crews. So it's Pendle and Daniels got the best of that. They're going to hit the water first.
They're going to be Spain. And I think the first Hungarian crew is there as well.
Nose of Italy's boat there. You saw that with the flag on.
Yeah.
French, possibly. So,
and Hungary.
Great Britain, Spain, Hungary.
Italy.
Now that's worth pressing on a little bit, I think, if you're the British team. If you can press on now and create a small gap, possibly the Spanish would take it on from there. I don't think they're going to be prepared to create the gap, but if a gap was made for them, they could use it.
Yeah,
but it looks like the others are going to close in.
I think so.
You got some good crews back there.
It used to be like that in K2 racing, in these early stages. They are so good. They have strength left good enough to close any gap.
So
this will be a very, very nice race, I think. A very good race. I'm really unfortunate to have to leave for the plane, and they're leaving this in the very good hands of Ivan. Thank you.
You're leaving right now, Stefan.
Yeah, I need to.
Oh my word! So I'm flying solo from now on.
Yes.
You have to bear with me without the professional help of Stefan Gustafsson. Thanks, many thanks, Stefan.
Thank you
for my
Ivan.
Education on my first go at commentary. So flying solo now. You're going to have to forgive me any of my errors. You can always write in and complain. In fact, we were going to start a competition during this weekend. Stefan and I, we've made some deliberate errors along the way. That we hope that when you review all the footage, you'll be able to pick out the deliberate errors. And if everyone can get all 12 of them, there are 12 to find, then we will give you a special prize after the World Championships this year.
And they are all spread out in all the different events, so you need to watch them on YouTube. And there is 12 errors, and if you find them, you will get a good prize at the World Championships in Győr.
Fantastic. So we've got that to look forward to. And in the meantime, it's goodbye to Stefan. And
good luck, Ivan. And
thanks a lot.
thanks all of you all over Europe that have been patient enough to watch us this weekend. And next time we will probably have a technological status that will be suitable for this kind of broadcasting as well. Thanks a lot, and welcome back.
So Stefan, I know, really feels like he's missing out on this race. We've had such good races today, and all weekend, in fact, that it does seem a little bit harsh that he has to leave now. Men's K2, any of the senior men's race, we've got a little bit more affinity for, having both of us raced in the past. And he's got a plane to catch, important work to do when he gets home. So it's just me. In fact, the big cheese, Alan Laws, has come to collect him. He's just been told off. And that's how it rolls around here. When the big cheese comes round, we jump, don't we, Alan? And the big cheese, even the big cheese, has an even bigger cheese above him. And there's no end to the size of cheese in this place. Okay, so see you all, and good luck. So a long shot at the back of the group. Looks like it's those first five, possibly six, in that front group. But the first four really look the most comfortable. That's the two Spanish, the Hungarians, and Pendle and Daniels, who did a great portage, tidy in, tidy out, and managed to split up that group quite comfortably, really. There certainly wasn't any rush about it. Very well organised. I know they fancy their chance of a medal. I spoke to their coach earlier, Dyson Pendle, from Norwich Canoe Club, running a great program up there. Andy Daniels trains with Tom Daniels and the group at Longridge Canoe Club. They also have a very progressive group there. And in fact, I owe a bit of an apology from this morning, from the Junior K2 to the crew at Chelmsford Canoe Club, for not mentioning them during the K2 Junior race, in which they had an athlete who came fourth. I had to say that. Keith Moore told me to. Okay. Not much we can see from there. So looking out across the lake. A lake surrounded by holidaymakers. Got parachutes in the sky. That race is still plugging away at the back there. That's the Czech crew, Adam and Jezek. And back to the front. Just the four boats now. So Pendle Daniels, they'll be prepared to put in the work. To their left, Hungarians, and then the Spanish, and of course the other Spanish. So between them, these four should be motivated to maintain the gap on those others. They know how hard it is out there in the heat, and to catch up in the heat actually makes things even tougher. So it looks like the Spanish, Alonso, Merchan, they're going to take their turn. If Pendle and Daniels are lucky, they'll be able to drop straight into the diamond behind. Perfect job. It's almost your privilege as the previous leader. If you choose that diamond, then generally you're allowed to have it. Merchan and Alonso always have a high cruising speed. So there's the graphic at that turn, just before that change of lead. It's Pendle Daniels, Merchan Alonso, Salty Boros, and Buzan Fernandez. French dropped just about 8 seconds behind with their group, which includes the Italians and the Belgians. And then it's a further 20 seconds back to the Hungarians and the Portuguese. So we've lost the ability to have philosophical debate with Stefan, now he's left. So it's down to raw commentary. I am getting a little bit of internet. So if anyone wants to send questions into my Facebook account, if there's anything they want answered, please do that. There's a small chance that I may be able to receive that message and respond to it. So looking back up the course, looks like we've got a recreational canoe there, fancying its chances, but unfortunately it's been left for dead by the professionals. So three boats in that group. The wind's just come through the commentary box, and my papers and all my information is now scattered neatly across the floor of the tent. Just having a quick tidy up while the boats are up the course, so bear with me. Trying to get myself organized. And there you can see the gap between first and second. Looks like that second group sort of getting a little bit bigger. Just the three boats there. So it's a bit difficult for me to tell where exactly we are. That's the front group just going around that top turn. Well, no, that's in fact the second group you're seeing there going around the top turn. The front group's about another 20-30 seconds in front of them. So the group we're looking at there is the French, the Italians, the Belgians, and then back, the group we're looking at now is Denmark, Portugal, and Hungary. So Peters Corrin from Denmark. Corrin raced earlier this weekend. Pretty good result for him. Very strong in the early stages. Perhaps the heat, perhaps just lack of experience in this sort of level of racing got to him in the end. but he's definitely started off strongly. So front group. Think is what you see there. You can see how close the second group are. Just a 10-15 seconds behind. And as they come down towards the turn boys in front of me, it will be their second portage. So it looks like the Hungarians leading. Spanish giving the British team a hard time there. They've fallen back onto the tail of the Hungarians, which means the Great British boat has to trawl along in the back. It looks like Merchan Alonso had a plan. A plan which mainly was made to damage the Great Britain boat and their comfort within the group. So Hungarian drink bag thrown into the lake again. And the Spanish take on the lead yet again with Buzan Fernandez. Buzan Fernandez, second in this event last year, second in 2011, second in Oklahoma, second in Denmark, second in Rome. The last win they had was in Singapore 2011, and they won previously in 2010, but they are always there or thereabouts. But the crew to beat, first place in the Europeans last year, first place the year before, first place, or at least Merchan first place in Poland in 2009, and wins in Denmark in 2013 and Rome 2012 at the World Championships. There is no end of quality in that front group. So here they come, just about 100 meters before the turn, and then from the turn it will be coming through to the second portage. Around they come. There shouldn't be too much of a panic into here. Four boats easily accommodated on the landing stage. But we have seen the Spanish early today deliberately making life difficult for opponents. All obviously perfectly within the rules. It's all part of the game. No one minds it. Doesn't mean you enjoy it, obviously, if you're being pushed around, but it's how it works. So Pendle Daniels very comfortable in the diamond wash. Actually, now Stefan's gone, I can call it the V-wash, which is what I would normally call it. So in the V-wash, that's the wash where you're on the tail of the leader and the side of either crew, either side of the leader. So you can see them tucked in the back there. It's the biggest wave there is, making your life as easy as possible. There go the Hungarians. They're having a little sprint for the portage. All this sprinting's got to come to something. It's energy spent. What are they going to do when they come out the other end? If they're going to do this now, then they have to make something of it. The chance of them making something of it this early in the race is slim. So what was all that fuss about? So Hungarians out, they're up and running. Buzan Fernandez, they're out, they're up and running. Alonso Merchan and then Daniels Pendle, last to get out there. A little bit balked by the Spanish. Little bit of confusion, and it's given the Hungarians three or four lengths of leeway. Whether they'll use that to get away or just to have a rest, we'll find out in a minute. But I suspect, I don't know, maybe I'm judging them on my mentality, but I would take a rest now. I'd definitely take a rest. But they're not going to. They've pulled away hard. Now, the predictability of these guys is such that you do see these guys putting their boats inside the other boat because they know how fast they're going to get away. They know that everything's going to be okay. So there's a chase. That is a proper chase on there. Hungarians are going for it. Great Britain, just a few lengths adrift, but I would suspect that pace will slow fairly soon. Great Britain don't need to panic. They need to find a big rolling wave behind that group and sit there until the pace slows. You don't need to climb over waves while they're going too fast. Just wait for the pace to slow and don't lose ground. Find a big rolling wave, guys. But that pace is, and there you go. Then the pace drops and that's when you can slot into the back. Is anyone taking it on? Buzan Fernandez, the leaders, not sure the speed is quite so high as the Hungarians. So Pendle Daniels, now see a V-wash opened up there. There is one there when they get there. So it's worth the effort, guys. They're obviously not as close as they seem because they're still coming out wide. The Hungarians have gone again. The Hungarians are intent on making this a permanent break by the looks of it. A permanent break here would guarantee them a medal, but it also guarantees that they can't have a V-wash for the entire rest of the race, and they will be two against one with the Spanish. If I were the Hungarians here, I'd be tempted to make friends with the English. There's no telling when you need a friend later on in the race. But they are certainly pressing on. There's no doubt about that. They're not hanging around. You can see how much that gap's opened up before the second group. Second group came in just a few lengths behind. And Pendle Daniels really working hard. Really working hard there. And still they're not in contact. The lead changes again. It's the Spanish again now. And finally, Pendle Daniels' rate has dropped. Hopefully that means that they've tucked themselves onto that leading V. Now the job is to get the breathing back under control, get the waist out of their muscles, get relaxed, regroup, maybe even have a little chat with each other, ask how everyone's doing. Ask how hard that was, and as soon as they're back in the V, the whole pace stops. So it was an attack. It was a fact-finding mission for all the teams there. Pendle and Daniels will be relieved that they held their own against the three other boats. And everyone else knows that they're good enough to close at least once. And they all know now how fast each other leads. But it's not over for Pendle and Daniels. They've been pushed out of the V. They've had to come around the side. That will really not cheer them up any, but with the speed as it is, they'll get on the side and they will be able to relax. So at some stage, either at the top turn or maybe after the portage there, we'll have a graphic of the split times. It's a group of four followed by a group of three and then another group of three. Everyone else is pretty much in ones and twos now, and they have got a long, long journey in a very hot lake basin. Few crews have come in already, looking out from commentary position here. I haven't got the binoculars anymore, they belong to Stefan. So it looks like it could be a Portuguese crew, very likely I think to be Romalo. He did not look well after his race yesterday. Supreme effort. He didn't mean to break away when he did, it happened by chance. Took him a little while to realize that the break was made, and when he did, he was fully committed. And when he finished that race yesterday, it took him probably 10 minutes before he was comfortable standing, and it wasn't looking good for him. He went out today with one of his best friends and promised him that they'd race still, but I'm kind of hoping that the crew I can see coming in is Romalo. You don't need to hurt yourself that much, and if you do hurt yourself that much, then you really don't need another tough day the next day. But when the graphics come up, we'll find out who's left out there and who's not. And another crew coming back there. So these ones will at least have to come past my commentary position. So looks like the Germans. So Berger and Horn from Germany. Or maybe Schubert and Paufler, will find out when we can see their number. But every single one of these athletes that comes off, everyone you interview, everyone you speak to, is 703, the number on that boat, and which is odd because on the start list I haven't got one of those. So anyway, when they come past, hopefully I'll just check with Jim to see if he knows who the other crew was that came in. Yeah, just had confirmation that it was in fact Romalo. I was hoping it was. He hurt himself too much yesterday and he really didn't need to be doing that again today. I think for his own health and the rest of his racing year, that's probably a very, very wise decision on his part. So the pace, now everyone's back in that front group. The pace has dropped dramatically. No one needs to do anything just now. The gap's increased to a stage where they've got a safety cushion. Just have a little bit of regrouping. So 703, sorry, Suchet and Frick from Germany. It was all too much for them. The reason I couldn't find them on the other list was because the other list was the wrong list. So you can add that to make number 13 of the mistakes. I've given you that one for free. So if you can find the other 12 mistakes we made actually deliberately, apparently, then prizes are waiting for you after the World Championship. So Boozan Fernandez, Salty Boris, Pendle Daniels, Merchan Alonso, as it has been for some time. Second group, three boats, the French, the Italians, and the Belgians. Boulanger, Graziani, and Corin. So three boats in that group there. It's either the so we've got Hungary, Portugal, and Denmark. So the Hungarians there will be Meseros and Gear. The Danes, I'm not sure, Nikolai Black maybe, and Elias Riom-Kremer. But I'm really guessing the other crew on my start list is Nikolai Mork and Mads Pedersen, who was really the superstar from yesterday's. Right, actually, that's a bit harsh on Romalo, isn't it? Let's have Romalo down as the superstar of yesterday's race, closely followed by Mads Pedersen, who came a rather unfortunate yet heroic fourth. So, since asking you to send messages into my Facebook, I haven't been able to get hold of my Facebook, obviously. So, no joy there. If you have sent something in, I may get it at some stage, so I've got a couple of messages. Here we go. I've got a couple of messages coming in from Great Britain people saying, where is Keith Moore's K2? Well, Keith Moore's K2, I think, is on the trailer. Only one great British boat out there today, and that's Pendle Daniels. So I think, yep, Keith's boat's probably dried out, put in its bag, and on the trailer. Well, Keith suns himself sipping pina coladas on his sun lounger just to my right here on the beautiful sandy beach. I hope that answers your questions. So a bit of downtime here. We've got the graphic telling you exactly what's happening in terms of times. No changes there. You got pretty much a 20 second gap to the second group. Then you got a 40 second gap to the third group. And then after that, actually, Adam and Jacek, who were I'm presuming they swam early on. They were certainly last around the bottom turn here the first time. They're moving up through the field. They're 12th place now. I said to Stefan before he left that they're going to stay last throughout. He assured me they wouldn't. He said to me, his words to me, Jezek is hard as nails, he said. So, Jezek proving him right there. I find it very bizarre almost to see guys that I used to race so many years ago still out there. And it makes you feel like you want to be out there yourself. But I can rationalise that slightly, and I know that if I was out there working as hard as he is, I would be thinking completely differently. So, in shot there, a group of three. I've got the same heat haze picture that you have, and actually I have no idea who they are. So apologies for that. I am giving it my best shot. But from the commentary position, that's the view I've got. You've got the same view now. It's the leading group. Second group, closed some distance down since that escape attempt after the portage. Working comfortably as a group. They'll keep an eye on that second group. They'll keep the distance to a distance they like it, not that the second group likes it. It would take a very sustained effort from that second group to close that gap. And actually, even if they did, I think those front four would feel that that extra effort the second group had applied would render them pretty much void in terms of taking positions in the front group. So here we go, Alonso Merchan, Pendle Daniels, Buzan Fernandez, and the Hungarians there nicely tucked into the V-wash. So Salty's second outing of the weekend. Try and get a few stats on you for them. Boros fourth in K1 at the Europeans last time. Salty and Boros fourth in Oklahoma as a K2. Seventh the year before in Denmark. So it seems like they're on the climb. Salty obviously not available for last year's Europeans, but you only come fourth so many times before you get hacked off with that, and the desire for third or at least grows and grows. So they're approaching the turn before their third portage now. So two portages down, eight laps, seven portages. Shouldn't be any stress again. But even though there was no stress last time, you saw that there was still a break made. The second group's coming through. Actually, a very good old friend of mine, Rennie Vesterborg-Larsen, properly into his marathon paddling. In fact, a legend in his own mind, as well as a few other people's. He sent in a confirmation that I shouldn't be out there. He said it would be fun to be in shape and participate, but in reality there's no champagne on the water, and here I am in my commentary tent surrounded by the stuff. So Rene, you are absolutely right, mate. I'm staying in the tent and I am sipping my champagne. Also got another question from, I'll come back to that in a minute because we're coming up to the pontoon. Absolutely, you can see yourselves. There's no rush into there. Pendle, good move, overtaking the Spanish in a very positive way. Spanish out, next Spanish, then Pendle Daniels. Hungarians faffing a bit there, grabbing hold of the boat. They'll run well. They were strong on the water anyway, and I can't see anything changing from that. Second group already into the pontoon now. 7-0-1, you're the Italians. They're first out, the Belgians. And 7-0-1, the French. They were good early on, but in come the front group. And a little bit of a concerted effort by the Spanish. Merchant having a look round, see if they've done any damage, or any damage worth capitalising on. So it's 3-4 boats, nothing exceptional is going to happen here. No real gaps, everyone's got overlap, and that will just reform. So, from Dave Francis, any idea why Merchant is sitting in the back of the K2? He says, I've only ever seen him in the front seat. Why would they switch? Obviously, I don't know, Dave. I haven't spoken to them, but I do know that after yesterday's race, Merchant was not in good shape. He was, in his own words, he was feeling his age, he said. And I think maybe it's hot out there. Maybe he thought that Alonso was the stronger of the two. Yesterday, he obviously got the better result. And maybe they made their decision based on that. Third group coming through the portage now. There go the Danes. 7-10. That's Black and Riom Kramer. With them, the Portuguese, that's going to be Faria. Portuguese. 7-12, Faria and Maciel from Portugal. And 7-14 with them, that's the second Hungarian boat, Mezeros and Gear. And those three have got a long journey ahead, but they've got each other for company. So good news that a few questions are coming in. At least that means the live feed is getting out, maybe, which makes everything seem that little bit more worthwhile. Got Jim Rosser coming in. He was asking my opinion on whether the Hungarians were struggling a bit. Certainly looked stronger coming out of the previous portage, didn't they? And
last in, last out,
and a bit shabby getting out of the boat as well. You lose your coordination a bit when you're feeling a bit shabby. But leading this next group in is Jacob Adam and Thomas Jezek. Thomas Jezek, older than the entire Swedish K2. And
they capsized.
We saw that earlier on. They were the blue team I talked about that were way behind. Stefan had belief in them. He believed they could catch up. And it turns out, as has been so right so many times this weekend, I've been wrong and Stefan was right. That's probably why he's had the job for a long time and I'm just starting out. Oh no, there he goes, he's taken a bit of a tumble, I think tripped by his own support crew there, and that, worse than that, the rudder has just been bashed on the fence. Now I hope for their sake that when they get in here they don't just peel off to the left with a bent rudder. Skidding down the landing stage for the Belgians, they need to be cautious as well. You don't need a slip. Check guys away and away fast, and it looks like they do have directional control over their boat, so a small incident didn't cost them anything other than a bit of embarrassment, and Thomas Jezek will be able to laugh that off after this race. But it looks like they made the break on their group, which may move them up from something like 12th. When we get the graphic, I reckon they could be up to around 10th place by now, maybe even more than that. I think there's 4 in the front group, 3 in the group behind them. That's 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. No, they are still 12th position. 12th position, but a very good 12th position when you consider where they came from. Blimey, putting out that I need questions brings some people out of the woodwork. Simon Van Longhausen, how are you doing, old man? So, Simon used to race for the Irish team years ago, used to train with us at Elmbridge Canoe Club sometimes, massively entertaining guy. He's asking me if racing K1 and K2 at the same championships is a good idea or not. That depends who you are, I guess. I'll come back to that part of the question. Did I ever do it? No, I didn't. Partly because I didn't want to, partly because I don't genuinely think I was ever rough or tough enough to do that, and partly because the races were slightly longer back then. So you were looking at races up to 3.5 hours back in my day, and to double up on that didn't seem practical. Is it a good idea? I don't know. Ideally in your country you have enough guys to fill all the slots with the same sort of quality, but these guys like racing. They seem to repeat, and doing the K2 the next day very often. I remember the Dutch guys, Edwin Denise and Dolph de Lund, they used to race K2 the second day, and very often their K2 result was better than their K1 results. And I don't know. These guys don't seem to have any problem with it. The idea terrifies me personally, Simon, and I'm too much of a softie to even attempt it. So thanks for the question. Much appreciated and great to hear from you. So front group there making their way up to the top turn. Hungarians again leading. Salty, Boros. Jim was questioning how they were feeling. A valid question, I think. Of course, the other bit of that question, Simon, is that you know who I was racing K2 with, and to keep him calm while I was racing K1 might have been too big a job, to be fair. So, Salty Boros, they're certainly not looking like they're holding back there. Those boats are moving well. Flanked by the two Spaniards, which is great news for Great Britain because they are tucked away tidily in that V-wash, getting as much rest, as much recovery as they can. Interestingly, there's been some sort of team politics aired on social media this week, which is very unusual from these guys. I know some of the Spanish are a little bit unhappy about situations with sponsors and federation sponsors, personal sponsors. And that all seemed to have come to a bit of a head this weekend. I'm sure that hasn't created a harmonious atmosphere in the team camp. But sometimes athletes get to a stage where they're so frustrated that vocal objection is their only option, or at least that's how they feel. They don't feel they have a say unless they say it publicly. So, Salty Boros, Merchan Alonso, Buzan Fernandez, Pendle Daniels. Second group, Boulanger, Iverson, Graziani, and then Peters and Corrin. Still only 15 seconds behind. Now, we saw in the junior race this morning that the Danes were at least 15 seconds behind at some stages, and they still came through to get a medal. I think that's a big ask when you're looking at the names in that front group today. But nothing's impossible. We've seen accidents, we've seen incidents, we've had surprises. The pundits in the commentary box have been proved more wrong, more than they've been proved right, I think, this weekend. So 7:12 there. It's a shot of that third group. Farrier, he raced yesterday. He'll be feeling the heat. Black and Riom Kramer from Denmark, and the second Hungarian crew, Mezeros and Gear. These groups will pretty much remain unaffected. The only people out there motivated to break up their group at the moment seem to be Adam and Jezek. They are men on a mission. They upset themselves in the early stages, and now they are out to pick off everyone they can pick off, make their point, and at least come out of this race with some pride. So three portages down, not even halfway yet. So that was Merchan Alonso putting their paddles down. They feel they've done enough of the work and they've earned the right to a free ride tucked behind their countrymen, Buzan and Fernandez. The work share in a group like that that's got no real motivation other than to hold off the group behind, will be shared pretty much equally, I would imagine. If your leads are weak, it doesn't make you popular in a group like that. They've got a simple job to do, is just to maintain that lead and keep themselves safe for the latter stages of the race. But there's still a concerted effort in that second group. It's not over yet for them by any means. They haven't lost any distance over the last couple of laps, and the chase is still on. So it looks to be the Italians leading that chase at the moment. It's Bonaccina and Vincenzi. But I'm sure that second group is also trading leads. They don't want to lose ground just to have a fight among themselves. There you can see the gap. Maybe 20 seconds. But not changing dramatically. So you've got Belgium there as well. Corin, Peters, and the French, who looked so strong early on, Boulanger and Candy. And so it comes to the Hungarians to take their turn. Salty, Boros, just keeping up a nice, sustainable tempo as they approach the turn before the portage. And we go through the same routine. So it looks like the cloud cover they promised is not going to appear. So the little bit of rain or thunder that they predicted is not going to come in. Lighten the heat load on these paddlers out there today. They're stuck out there in the relentless heat. They're going to be looking forward to a bucket of water there over their head come the portage, and maybe a new drink around their neck if they are well organized. Their support crew will have had chilling for them. I think an ice and a slice might be a bit ambitious, but certainly cool drink would be appreciated at this stage. So they've rounded that turn. Second group is closer, I would say, than they have been in previous laps. But there's enough wisdom in that front group to make the decision themselves as to whether that second group is allowed to catch up or not. Let's check out the timing in those front two boats there. And for some reason, they've decided to have a flare up into that portage. It's the Hungarians again. Maybe they do not want to be straggling out like they did at the last portage. They're doing no damage to anyone there. You can see Alonso, he's not going to be worried by that. Pendle and Daniel's not worried. And of course, Buzan and Fernandez neatly tucked in the back on the V. Pendle and Daniel's in a little bit of trouble here. They've overshot the portage. It's going to be tougher getting our boat out, but absolutely recovered from that. It's totally smoothly. You've got to hand it to Pendle for that one. Didn't panic. He found himself in a bad position and dealt with it absolutely perfectly. So Hungarians running well. They obviously didn't enjoy being out of the portage last time. Merchan Alonso second, and then the Great Britain crew and the other Spaniards should be coming into the water now. It's Great Britain struggling to get the nose of their boat in. He's put the nose in first instead of the tail. After the genius they had at the front end of the portage, they make a schoolboy error there. Wait for the back of the boat to get in. And the Hungarians are capitalising on this. They've seen gaps appear. They know those gaps will probably be closed, but they're going to make some people suffer. And those people at the moment are the Great Britain guys. The two Spaniards are together. Even if they don't catch up, they've got company and they'll catch up later. But it's Great Britain that have suffered in this. It's such a shame. Pendle did such a good job at the outset of that portage. He was forced to a position he didn't want to be. He made the best of it. He ran with all the other teams. And then a small error getting in. And that is costly. That error is going to cost them probably at least 5 minutes of hard, hard work now. Not only hard, hard work, but that is mentally stressful. Your brain starts wondering, can you do it? Can you climb over the next wave? The waves start to look a little bit bigger at that stage when you're climbing over them. But the following groups are coming. It's the group with Hungary. Missed the others, I'm sorry. I've been looking out the window of my tent instead of commentating on what you can see. So it's Portugal, Faria, it's the Danish crew, and it's Hungary. So Gear and Mezeros, the Danish crew, and Faria, and I've forgotten his Maciel. I forgot his name for a minute there, apologies. So, they're all in another tumble there. Actually, you see the black strip on the landing stage there? That's really soft and dips down. It's the gap between two separate pontoons. That doesn't cover it in a hard way. If you put your foot on there, you're very likely to go over on your ankle. It's a little bit dodgy. And it's the same on the out ramp and on the in ramp. Also, the pontoons are floating pontoons. And when you run down onto them, they start to wobble a little bit. And if you've got wobbly, jelly legs at that stage, you're a bit tired, then it's really hard to keep your balance. So those groups are up and through the portage. The hunt is still on for Pendle and Daniels. When I look out the window of my commentary tent, they're still running very, very wide of the group. Good, wise tactic there from Pendle. He's doing a great job here today. All the other groups over the portage, and in come Jezek and Adam. They did make the break on the group that they came in with the portage last time, and they are still making relentless progress through this field. So they're coming to the portage now, and I can't make out what picture we're being shown. It's just too hazy. But the picture we've got now is the next group coming into the portage. We're looking at the young Swedes, first year seniors here. And with them, the German crew, the only remaining German crew in the race. And in the blue shirts, I would be guessing if I told you who they were, but I'm thinking Italy. We'll see when we get to see their backs. Then they got the three colours of the Italian flag on the back, hopefully. Boat 705. No, I must have read that wrong. 705. Tells me that's the Swedes in blue. I'll try and get confirmation from that from you. But these are the tail enders. The sharp end of the race are heading up towards the turn. And the bad news for Great Britain is that, as far as I can tell, that gap between the first three and Pendles and Daniels is not closing. In fact, it looks horribly like it's getting bigger. And there are some really negative thoughts creeping in to the brains of Pendle and Daniel. You have to push them out. You have to get back onto a positive note. You have to regroup. The race has changed for you now, and your whole motivation has to change with that change of situation. They've got to settle into something, and they've got to settle into something they can sustain until either somebody from the group behind catches them up and they can begin a group race again, or they just finish this race on their own. But that scenario will pan out over the next few laps. It's a little bit sad for Great Britain. They'd done so well, I couldn't believe it. They'd done so well at the start of that portage, and then it all went wrong in a moment. There's confirmation, there's the front three. Salty Boros, Spaniards flanking them. Salty and Boros now, they have got a job to do here. Those Spaniards will have so much experience between them, they can work these Hungarians over, assuming they're fit and strong enough to do it after yesterday's efforts. Salty and Boros certainly still piling on. They're certainly, that still means they have some concern that they'll be caught by the boats behind them. The Spanish, I really don't think, care whether someone catches them or not at this stage. The downside of not letting Daniels and Pendle catch is that, of course, there's no diamond wash anymore. There's no V-wash. There's no definite rest position in that group. You can see Fernandez and Buzan, they've dropped back onto the tail of the Hungarians. Hungarians feel like they've done their bit, and they're passing it over. The Spanish, really not quite as motivated, are they? Merchan, Alonso felt it was their duty. You could see it was a duty thing. They didn't do that willingly. And they're just going to take the sting out of the speed. Buzan and Fernandez have no objection to that. They're going to take the opportunity to grab a drink. And you can see that gap. That is... whoa. Hopefully the camera missed Daniels and Pendle in the speed of the pan there. This is the French, the Belgians and the Italians. Somewhere in that speed pan we had from the cameraman was Pendle's and Daniels, I hope. Oh no, there they are. They've dropped back to that group. There's the nose of their boat there. So they made a decision. They didn't want to run on their own, and they'd rather have the company and the comfort of a wash hanging group. You could argue either way. I know that if Stefan were here, he would argue that was a bad move. Very much of the opinion that if you're on your own, you press on. I think I would side with Pendle and Daniels. They weren't going to come any higher than fourth anyway. And now, at least they've got a bit of a ride round. If you go around on your own and you blow out completely, then everyone, but everyone, will come past you. And at that stage, there's nothing you can do about it. So good decision, I think, by Pendle and Daniels. Maybe forced on them. Maybe not a decision they wanted to make. But it's a decision they have made. And now their race starts again, just with different company. I imagine that group of three is fairly happy to see them. It means they get a V-wash in their group. Finally, they can have a sensible, serious rest every turn, if you like, every time someone else takes the lead. So they will be grateful. And of course, each one of those in that group feels that now they have an opportunity for fourth place, which up until that point, of course, they didn't. But we've seen things change in these races. Seen it before, and we'll see it again, I'm sure. Just relax for a bit until they come down to this turn. I'm going to have a little sip of water. Champagne's run out, you understand? I will be sending the maid for more champagne and more strawberries. In the meantime, it's water for me. So I'm missing Stefan's insight into how some of these guys might be thinking. Working with him over this weekend has been a real eye-opener for me. When I race, I only saw the race in one way, and it seems he saw races in a completely different way to how I saw them. Equally successful in many ways, and it's opened my eyes to the fact that actually, although I still believe in my way, it may not be the only way, which up until this point I believed that it was. So you can always learn. Doesn't matter how old you are, how experienced you are, you can always learn from someone else. If I did have my time again, though, I still don't think I'd be brave enough to race how Stefan raced. But Stefan, of course, three-time silver medalist at the first three World Championships from 1988 onwards. 88, 90 and 92. Obviously, they were only held every second year at that stage. So he lived through the horrors of Nottingham in 1988, which we all prefer to erase from our memories. Horrific weather, flooded river. Then on to 1990 in Copenhagen, a race he really feels he should have won. And he says his wife still nags him about him throwing that race away all these years on. Then finally, 1992 in Brisbane, where he raced 3.5 hours, the longest World Championships to date. And the way it's going, it will be the longest one ever. And came down to a showdown between myself and him. And to be fair to Stefan, it was sheer luck that got me away from him towards the end. It was an incident with a motorboat. And I know at the time he didn't enjoy that, but was gracious enough to be very kind to me afterwards. And having spent a whole weekend with Stefan, you realise you don't know them too much after all, but having spent a weekend with him, I realise what a great guy he is, and a great attitude to the sport, great attitude to other athletes. So this is the second group we're watching: Italy, Great Britain now, France and Belgium. Lead group in shot, and we're coming up to the portage. First the turn, though. Everything pretty relaxed here. These guys have already gone through the thought processes. As Daniels and Pendle fell off and dropped right back to that second group, in their minds, ka-ching, they've logged a medal already. And then the thought processes change as to what colour that medal might be. So Salty Boros leading the charge around this turn. They seem the most motivated of the crews to drop Pendle and Daniels, which might mean they feel like they're the strongest boat in the race, but more likely that they're the most insecure boat in the race, and they feel they need that cushion. The Spanish didn't feel that need, or as they suggested yesterday themselves, maybe age is taking its toll. So really relaxed. It looks like the two boats on the left of your picture are coming into the right hand side of the pontoon. Alonso Merchan going left. No real rush. Last minute change of plan by the second Spanish crew there. Not sure why you'd do that, but they obviously have an idea. But so often in these races, rather than Spanish cooperation, you've seen Spanish against Spanish towards the latter stages of the race. Last year in Oklahoma, at the last portage, not taking any credit away from the South Africans, who won that race with immense power over that last stage. But at that portage, the last portage, it was clear that the Spanish were more concerned with each other than they were with the South African crew. So here we go, they're both getting in on the left side of the pontoon, leaving the right side empty for the Hungarians. Everyone in and away. There's really no future in rushing off from here. So I expect them just to paddle gently away. Front man in the Hungarian boat really doesn't need to be pulling like that when his back man's not with him. There is no rush. That's 10 strokes. They would have been extremely heavy strokes with your back man just fiddling around with his drink system. That's not a problem of the back man. The back man wants a drink. That's fair enough. It's a bit foolish on the part of the front guy who's persisting despite all the evidence that his back man isn't ready yet. So in come the second group. It's France and Italy to the left side of the pontoon. It's Great Britain and Belgium to the right. Heads look a little low in that Great Britain boat, to be fair. They've balked the Belgians by stopping early. Belgians are not best pleased with that, but that's fair play to the Great Britain crew. They thought it through. They're running, but not with the same spring in their step they had earlier. And through come the French, first in the white, Italians blue. Support crew looking left and right, making sure he's not going to get speared by the next boat through the portage. So those two, a little bit of a gap. Yellow nose of Pendle Daniel's boat there, and the Belgians, who have every right to be a little bit miffed after that treatment from Pendle. French away, Pendle Daniel's away, Italians away, and Belgians away. There will be no change. No change in the front group either. As I look out my window, French there waiting for their group to catch them up for a bit of help. And after that second group, third group still hasn't even reached the portage. Second group's away and gone. Third group with the Portuguese, Danish, and the second Hungarians. In shot now. Looking a little bit drained. A little bit of a flurry there from the Danes. Typically, when I was, you see them speed up to come into the portage. I guess they're just defending their side, but actually, they're the only boat on this side of the pontoon. So all that speeding up, it costs energy. Now, as a rule, bit of hassle there on the far side. Portuguese slip over. Hungarians up and away. And here we go, it's the Danes coming through. Both have a watch on their boat there. I don't know what that would be measuring. Time, obviously, that's what watches measure. But I don't know whether they need to know time, or maybe it's heart rates. I'm not sure exactly. Coming into the portage now, crew from Poland, and not far behind them, it's the relentless chase of Jezek and Adam. You have to admire them for that. So, we're just watching, not sure what we are watching there. I think that's the group that's just come through with the Portuguese, the Danes in it, and the Hungarians. So what I was going to say, when the Danes come in, they're putting in all that effort to come in. And if they're not going to intending on making a break, then that effort really comes to nothing. So a rule I always used to work by when I was racing was that unless the effort I'm putting in is hurting someone else more than it's hurting me, then I'm not going to put any effort in. Universally disliked for that, obviously, among my fellow competitors, but they're my rules, and I was only worried about myself. I've changed since then, obviously. I've mellowed quite a lot. So there's Jezek and Adam. You can see they've got the bit between their teeth. They're running nicely, quick into the boat, both paddling exactly at the same time as they left. That's Adam in the front. He didn't do one paddle stroke without Thomas Jezek being ready, and that's experience on Thomas Jezek's part. He's been in the front of these boats before, and he knows exactly how painful it is for that front guy if they have to paddle while you're fiddling about trying to get in the boat. So they're going to pick up another couple, at least, before the end. And I think now that's the fifth portage done. We haven't had a screen graphic for a while, so I'm guessing that system's struggling a little bit. I know on the pontoons where the timing system works, because the pontoons are floating, changes the angle of the pickup devices, and that can be all it takes to not get a signal in those. They're a little bit sensitive. It's a work in progress. And a lot of time and effort's gone into those. They've been quite handy this week. But for this race, it looks like they might not be functioning too well. So, here we go. Back to the front group. A little bit lazy now from the Spanish. Merchan Alonso, they know what hard work costs over the second half of the race. They were out here yesterday. when they were really, I'm sure they won't mind me saying, they were really taken apart by Romalo in the new Cinco design boat from Nello Kayaks, one of the main sponsors of this event. And they're happy just to tap along. That is a case of just covering ground. They just need to cover ground and get as close to the end as they can with as little effort as they can, so that they're ready for whatever may come their way in the closing stages. When those closing stages begins varies dramatically from race to race. It can be 2 or 3K out. It can be just 500 meters before the finish. I'm not sure what decides that. I'm not sure what dictates that, but everyone knows when it happens. The change of mood. There's change in the levels of aggression. And the people's willingness to drop back onto a wash is reduced dramatically. So they're round the top turn. Meanwhile, in front of me in the commentary position, family paddling, sun hats on, shirts off, paddling an open Canadian around what must be one of the most beautiful lakes in Europe. And for them, life is looking great. A bit of downtime now while the paddlers are at the far end of the course. I'll have another sip of water. And let's have a few more questions, guys. If you want the time, Phil, if you just want me to shut up, you can text that in as well. I don't mind. I'll either ignore you or take some notice of you. Back to the second group there. Italians taking their turn. Great Britain coming to terms with their disappointment still, I imagine. They're still looking at that front group thinking there's an open V-wash up there. We were there, but for a simple error, we should still be there. France tucked in the back there. They're having a solid rest at the moment as the change comes in the front group. I think that is. Judging by the speed of that change, that'd be the Hungarians. They're the only ones who are motivated to pick the speed up. And it was really them that did the damage to Pendle and Daniels. Seems like my internet connection is down, so even if you are sending in questions, I can't see them. Portuguese, Danes and Hungarians, they seem to be moving well. Couple of young guys there, 21, 26, early days for them. Faria, 25, his partner already, 30. Then the Hungarians, Mazaros, very young, 22, and Gear, 25. So a lot of under 23s in this race, realizing that under 23 as an entity is only a brief diversion. Actually, once you leave junior, then the real target is senior and senior racing, where age really means nothing. It's very easy to get a bit low when you're one of the smaller, younger kids and you're getting beaten by kids twice your size. They're already shaving, losing their hair. But it all comes right in the end, I can assure you. You just need to keep plugging away, get your training in, have a bit of belief in yourself, and one day it will all come good. So Hungarians still motivated to keep that speed high at the front. Perhaps even they saw that the Spanish had weakness yesterday on the second half of the race. Maybe they've discussed it with their team managers. Maybe they've set out with a plan. They've done their share, they're dropping round, and it's Alonso and Merchan taking the lead. I'm surprised maybe they're not motivated yet this stage in the race, that the Spanish haven't started to gang up on the Hungarians a little bit. If the Spanish on the far side took the lead now, the Hungarians would have to drop round the back and come up their side. And of course, as soon as they've done that, the yellow boat of Merchan and Alonso could go again, and again the Hungarians would have to come round, and they could repeat that process over and over and over, and gradually suck the life out of that Hungarian boat. But there doesn't seem to be any motivation in that direction, which is either kindness on the part of the Spanish or self-preservation on the part of the Spanish. I suspect the latter, because they were out here yesterday, they know exactly how hot it is out there. Start messing about might not be top of their list of priorities. So really at this stage of the race, with groups this size, there's not much tactically to comment on. All the tactics are just in these guys' heads. They're trying to plan out how each lap will go, what position they need to be at the portage. There's no action that we can see as the spectators. All the action is internal. The thought processes are there. They run through scenarios in their head. They try and make judgments on who will be the stronger boat to sit with if it all kicks off, and every now and then there'll be a small test just to confirm what they think to be true. So here they come, a couple hundred meters to the portage. Wouldn't expect anything too exciting here. Should be just routine. So far the Spanish have been opting to go on the same side of the pontoon, the left side. Hungarians come in this side, maybe. Could well happen again. Or maybe the Spanish, as we saw the C2 do to the Hungarians, they'll just hold them off away from the pontoon by coming in on the same side of them as them. So here we go, as they approach, it's Spanish left and Hungarians right. Yellow boat will stop soon. Blue boat rather will go past them. And, well, uneventful, as they would like it. Maybe as spectators we want something different, but uneventful portage. No one running there with any intent. That's just running to get to the other end. All the boats will go in tidily. There'll be no rush. Nothing fancy. And away they'll go to continue their journey. A few holiday makers behind them, making the most of the sunshine here in Bahrain. And away they go. Just had the information that was portage 7 from the technical director there, which means they've got one full lap and one half lap to go. Fairly grateful for that information because I had that down as portage 6. So the second group, that's the back of that front group as they move away from the portage. Second group coming in, it's Great Britain and Italy coming right at the landing stage. It's France and Belgium going left. And I don't get quite a clear view from the commentary box, but cameras should pick up everything. So Pendle and Daniels again stopped fairly early. It's the French out first. Pendle and Daniels. Daniels struggling to get back to the handle on that boat. And all out, all up and away. Again, quite uneventful. French are running reasonably well, but not running in a way that would suggest they're planning on getting away. All down to the end of the portage now. And we'll watch the one of the following groups coming back in. So the portage. So this is the group with Hungarians, Danes, and the Portuguese. Behind them, on their own, we have the Polish, I think, and only three or four lengths behind them now, Adam and Jezek. It's been quite fun to follow their progress through this race. They are going to pick up the poles. They are going to overtake them at some stage, especially as the Poles just put their paddles down for a couple of moments there, and again to throw their drinks bag in the lake. Previous group just at the top of the ramp now, exit ramp. Denmark support crew about to put their drinks over the head of their competitors. I'm not sure if he missed that or not. That all got lost in the blackness of the screen there. So they're all going to be through the portage comfortably, all cleanly, just the three of them. One large lap and one small lap to go, and coming into the portage at the other end is Poland, and just three lengths behind them is Jezek and Adam. I suspect on this portage, Jezek and Adam will catch them up and they'll have company, but I suspect not for long because one of those crews is on a mission and the other one is falling back. So, it's the previous group paddling away from the portage. The front runners now well up the lake. I think the pace in the front group has slowed slightly, but they've still got a good long lead over that second group. Absolutely no danger of that second group closing them down. You can just about on that picture make out the three groups. So they're up the top of the lake, and we are left down here to talk amongst ourselves for a bit. It looks like I'm pretty much totally devoid of internet connection now. So your chances of getting any messages into me are somewhere between 0 and none. So I appreciate you could have been watching the Formula One today, or you could have been watching Wimbledon, but you've come to the right place. You are in Bohin, much, much better venue than either of those previous sporting events. And we'll try and keep the excitement levels reasonably high for you. Here we go, back up to the top of the course with the leading three. Now these guys, they've got about 3K to go to the last portage and only about 750 metres after that portage. Things are getting a little bit tenser now. Often before this sort of period of, they'll have a little bit of tension later on now. Maybe it's really relaxed, sort of fishing around their bodies, trying to find a little bit more energy from somewhere. And often at this dead patch, just before it all kicks off again, that's when you feel your worst. You start feeling the aches, you start feeling the pains. You need that little bit of extra adrenaline of getting nearer to the finish to make all those vanish and you get your priorities back in order. So, Buzan and Fernandez, one of the smoothest K2s out there, followed by Alonso and Merchan. They have to be feeling a bit of pinch from yesterday's 2 hours in the sun. And then Salty and Boros. They're still there, I'm sure. Yep, there they are. So everyone's through the penultimate portage. No stragglers left. I think we've had quite a few retirements today. And to be fair, if things weren't going your way out there today, I think it's just too hot and too unpleasant to force your way around a course like this. Far better to come back for a swim in the lake and an ice cream. So Belgium, Great Britain, Italy and France in that chase group. They've given up the chase, but they are still going to be fighting for pride at the end. I think that last portage in that group will be quite dramatic. There's a couple of people there who aren't portaging too smoothly already. And with a bit of added stress, that's the sort of group you could see an accident from. So there, going up, round the top turn. As we join the front group again, another drinks bag jettisoned into the lake. This time from Merchan. And it's a long wait now until they come back down. And from the time they get opposite the commentary box, that's when the tension is going to begin. So just the turn before the portage and the final turn to go, and a little bit of a flurry of activity. Not sure exactly what that was about. I don't see any gain from that. I don't see any change from that. And maybe we missed something on the screen there, but that confused me a little bit there. But it's Buzan and Fernandez. Now, it's not unusual. There they go. I was just going to say, it's not unusual for a crew in that position to decide from that sort of distance out that, as of now, no one overtakes us. We used to have that kind of agreement in RK2 when we used to race. At some stage, I'd turn around, give my partner a nod and say, that's it. As of now, we are the leaders. And from that point on, you defend your lead with everything you have. So Buzan, Fernandez, maybe have made that decision. Merchan, Alonso, they know them well. They know what their capabilities are. And Salty and Boros, they're all there still. Now, if you're one of those boats on that wash and you're not fast enough to get by on your own, there's opportunities will present themselves for an attack. Often, after one crew attacks, everything drops. The speed drops, the arms drop. And it's in that one moment there when everyone relaxes, if you go, you have a tiny, tiny window of opportunity to capitalize on that relaxation and get to the front. At this stage, they'll be acutely aware of the other two boats in their group. So it would seem the medals were sorted a long time ago. And the fight for the colour has already begun. So, of course, the portage offers another opportunity to overtake if you're not a stronger paddler. Buzan Fernandez looking ominously strong there. They didn't race yesterday. Their fellow countrymen did, and they suffered a little bit yesterday too. Salty also raced earlier in the weekend. That was a couple of days ago now. He should be recovered from that. So, about a minute to go to the turn in front of the commentary box. Another minute from that to the portage, and another 2.5-3 minutes from the portage to the finish. It's Buzan, Fernandez, flanking there, Merchan, Alonso, and Salty, and Boros from Hungary. Way, way back now is that second group. They'll be starting to fight out their own personal battles. Exactly the same routine as I've described for the front group. But round those boys, second boy, third, two to go, and then straight into the portage. I really think you can expect a flurry of activity into the portage this time. This won't be an entirely calm affair. Here we go. Beautiful coordination from Buzan. Fernandez there. Absolutely responded to that. They'll try and drop the speed as soon as they can. Basically, and then another attack. They cover that. Three strokes it took them to cover that second attack. Now they'll keep the speed reasonably high, but they are dictating the speed at this stage. Been pushed on just a little. But no one's coming past them. They fired up the music in the spectator area. Tension is mounting here. It's Spain from Spain. The blue boat, the Buzan Fernandez, looks to have more control than any of the others. They're out the boat well. The boat's up and they're running. Whoa, Merchan only just picked up the back of his boat before it hit the landing stage. It was the Hungarians who were third out. And, whoa, what happened there then? So, Alonso Merchant somehow overtook the blue boat of Buzan Fernandez, as have the Hungarians. That's just bizarre. So something weird happened there. Buzan and Fernandez have got in behind the Hungarians with their nose on the inside. Their work is massive from here if they're going to win this race now. They had everything under control. They were out of the portage first. Just when they're out of sight, something major happened and they lost their advantage. And now look at that. The amount of work they're going to have to do. They're going to get back on terms with Alonso Merchan. They appear to have more speed than the other crews, but it's very hard to overtake people with the experience that Alonso and Merchan have. They've got experience by the bucket load, and they will use every bit of that in the closing 3 minutes of this race. To be fair, that's made this race slightly more interesting now. Had Buzan entered the water first, I think it would have been game over. So you'd expect an attack probably just coming off the turn. To attack into the turn would be a little bit dangerous for Buzan. It leaves Alonso the opportunity to cut them into the boys and cut their progress off that way. It's rather too easy for someone with Alonso's experience to do that. I don't think Buzan would be foolish enough to do it. Into the portage now comes group two. It's France from Belgium, from Italy, Great Britain struggling rather, and not only that, they're going to get pinned on the outside of two boats on that side of the pontoon. They're in a lot of trouble in terms of time, but very smooth exit. Boats have been picked up. They're second, they're third out from that portage. It's the Belgians that were last, and they'll be running through the portage in third position. Meanwhile, up towards the turn go the three leaders. It's gold, silver and bronze. Still, we don't know the order, but it's Merchan, it's Alonso, just rounding the turn now on their inside. It's Buzan, Fernandez on the outside, Salty Boris. We know they've got a turn of speed, but at this stage of the race, is it going to be enough to get past the Spanish? For me, no, it won't be. Here it goes, just off the turn. It's kicking off. That's fantastic from Alonso Merchan. They knew they'd straightened up before the others. They were half a length ahead, and they took that opportunity just to create a little bit, not of a lead, just a little bit of confusion. And they're going to keep the speed reasonably high now. It's going to be reasonably high. They won't have a solid attack until a bit nearer home. They just want to keep the speed high enough to not encourage an attack from either of the other crews. Now, those other crews, if they could communicate, the best thing they could do is attack in turn. But you don't want to take turns, because what if it's not your turn at the end? So, oh, there's so much to think about for these guys right now. It's Merchan, Alonso in the right of the picture. It's Buzan, Fernandez left, slightly separate from them. The Hungarians, I don't think, have got what it takes now to get past these guys. So Merchan, Alonso, they're going to be disappointed from yesterday. A win here would cheer them up for the weekend. Boats now running. This is pretty much maximum cruising speed. This is as fast as cruising speed can be. There has to be a flurry. Somebody's got to take them on if they can. And here we go. This is it now. And it's Merchan, it's Alonso. They're too strong. Buzan, Fernandez, they're nowhere. And it's the Hungarians who are the only ones in with a shout. But there's no chance. Absolutely no chance. It's Merchan, Alonso. That is a great win after their efforts yesterday. And Salty Boris, got to be pleased with that. And for me, Buzan Fernandez must be kicking themselves. What happened on that portage? They're discussing it now. You can see they're discussing it now. It's a shame that's not on camera. But they are, they're not happy with each other. Shouting's a bit harsh. There's gesticulation. They're not happy with each other. They're not happy with what happened over the last closing stages of that race. But fair play to Alonso Merchan. An opportunity presented itself. They got in front. Their experience was way too much. Decisive bit there, really. Coming off that top turn. They knew as soon as they straightened up and the others weren't straight, that could get them a little bit of an advantage. Made the other guys work first. And from there on, it was just a case of holding on. You saw how high the cruising speed was coming in. They kept the cruising speed right to the end, and only did they have to match the flurry of the Hungarians, and the win was theirs. Okay, if I can now, I'm going to move down to the boat area there and we'll try and get an interview with the guys. And I'll be quiet for a moment now. And next time you hear from me, hopefully it'll be the microphone in my hand and some European champions standing by my side. See you in a moment. Okay, so I'm standing here with the very newest European champions in the whole venue. We saw them yesterday. Yesterday was silver and bronze for these two. Today is gold. Guys, how much better does gold feel than silver or bronze?
Well, yesterday in the K1 is some problem and with the speed in the Portuguese, the Ramalho is coming. And only people, the second group is see, but nothing in front. Yeah. Ramalho is perfect. Yeah. Coming, but today, Ivan and me are championship the last year, yeah. And I need the defender the title. But today I only think win.
And then from the last portage, you two, you're in the water first. Now I've seen you race many times. I've raced myself many times. And from when you're in the lead after the last portage, no one overtakes at that stage. It's too hard. But guys, your experience, there's no chance really. But
today the last portes ran more slowly than the other championship. Yeah. I think it's no possible coming only in front. Yeah. Hungary are very strong today. Yeah. And I know only in the sprint, the three balls, yeah, in the final, no? But yeah, only to the turn is in front. Slowly control, yep, and after the turn, yeah, come on. Boom. And now, yeah, is there is we moment the Ivan and me, and
you know that
only.
Okay, there is an inevitability when you have two guys with this experience, with this sort of strength. Check this out, man. Check that out. So with that sort of strength and this sort of experience, there is no way. It doesn't matter who you are. You do not overtake people like this.
With this partner, it's more easy. Yeah. I am best in K1. Yeah. More easy paddling K2.
Okay, it's much easier. Okay, Ivan, Well done. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, so that's the last race of this event. It has been the best European Championships I've seen for a long time. The quality of the racing was perfect. And we're here with two of the heroes of the weekend, Ivan Alonso and Emilio Merchan. Perfect. Thank you, guys. So having just met the gold medalist, we now meet the silver medalist from the European Championship. It was a tough race out there, and you guys, it seemed, did an awful lot of the work.
Yes, thank you very much, because this was a very hard race for us, and it's a big respect every guys, because we played with our role models, and it's very big result to us, I think. So we are really happy.
Exactly. I mean, you're the young guys. These guys have been around for a long time, and they've got results from it. They're world champions, they're European champions, they've got everything. You guys are relatively new, and you did the work. When the Great Britain team dropped off the group, it was you guys that made the, you did the running, you did the hard work to drop them. Did you do that deliberately? You think, right, three is medals.
Yes, in the I saw the second portage, we a little bit go to the lead, and after we realized that if we can do it again, maybe we can stop the English boat, and maybe we could reach the three medals, yeah. One of them. And after the fourth portage, we did it, and we just pushed and pushed and pushed away, and we were very satisfied when we reached the turn, and after we was only third.
You knew it was job done. Yeah. You know, then it's a medal. Then you have to decide what colour the medal is. Is it going to be gold, silver, bronze? Did you ever really believe that you could be gold medal?
Maybe, but we didn't think it, because the Spanish it's really strong, really strong, and they have many they have many results and tactics, and we maybe the silver medal was the realistic, yeah, yes.
And you got the silver medal, yeah. But and even at the end you were still challenging them, but to come past guys like that, it's not really possible, is it? You know, how hard do you have to try to overtake guys that are that strong?
Yes, they was.
They all they've seen is that finish line, and there's no stopping that. Yeah. So much respect to you two. You did all the damage that was done in that race to the other crews was done by you guys. The Spanish just waited and waited and waited, yes. And it was you guys that did the work. Really good to watch, yes. And much respect. Congratulations, and I'm sure we'll see much more of these two at the World Championships when it's at home. Which club are you from? Are you from Gyor?
No.
Oh, it could have been so good.
But we will make the preparation trainings at Gyor, and we hope that at the World Championships at Gyor we could reach the gold medal. But so this will be this will be the dream.
Excellent. So when you get back to Hungary, say hello to István Salga for me, because I used to race with István years and years ago. We raced in Gyor in 1998, maybe, a long time ago. So say hello to him, and we look forward to seeing you both in Gyor later in the year. Thank you very much.
Thank you very
Cheers.
Much.
Thank you.